Lord, I bless you. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, the entrance of your word give light and understanding to the simple. Jehovah, visit us in the name of Jesus. Visit us, O God, in the name of Jesus. We bless you. We adore you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' holy and anointed name, we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. A measure of faith. A measure of faith. That is the title. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. Everyone say a measure of faith.
Amen.
From the New Living Translation, it says, don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given you. And I like this. Said, don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given you. And that sounds very good because it is true. Be honest in your evaluation of who you are. One thing that jumped at you there is that honesty is and is still the best policy. And if you are a honest person, your evaluation will be correct of yourself. Not only when people see you, but also when no one sees you. Honesty is still the best policy. Number one, God has given each of us a measure of faith to help us in every situation of life. You had those testimonies of the lady that just applied for visa for our family in our own bedroom. And 6 days later, it was granted. What do you call that? Coincidence? It's the grace of God. But more so, more importantly, it was our own measure of faith that was put into action. Let's read that scripture again. It says there, for I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. I'm sure she must have made a honest evaluation of her chances to return to her according to her desire. A measure is something quantifiable, measurable, something that has the potential to get increased. Why was it that David challenged Goliath? You remember the story? David was the one that stood up against Mr. Goliath. Why not one of his older brothers who are more experienced in battle strategies than him? He was just an ordinary shepherd boy. But I know of a God that make wise the simple, that make the inexperienced to become wise. It was David's faith in God that made him to stand out, because he was hearing the bluffing of the Goliath, while others, his brothers and the soldiers, they melted in fear. David was hearing what this Goliath was saying. And David has to ask them, what shall be done to anyone that fights this Goliath? Faith of David, it was his faith that made him to stand out. Your faith is so unique to you. Somebody doesn't know what else to say in terms of his grammar. He said, it is so uniquely unique to you. And I agree with that. Your faith, it is what makes you different from others. And how you as a believer sees the world. If you are honest with yourself, your journey to victory in your assessment should be shorter because of your measure of faith. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 37, 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 37, moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. If you're a good Bible student, you will see this word that was repeated but twice, but in a different way. The Lord who delivered me, he will deliver me. And that will strike you in the sense that there was a precedence for David before he could confront Goliath. Hear what he said. The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. He saw the problem. He assessed the problem. Can you see the problem you are in? Is there a problem at all that will make us to present this to God? David acknowledged that. And Saul, the king, said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. Say amen. Amen. The same God who delivered David from the lion and the bear now is confronted by Goliath. David remembered and said, God will deliver me from this Philistine. When your attitude is right, God will give you the right altitude in life. The problem that confronts us from time to time, God knows about them because he has said he will never leave us nor forsake us. But in most cases, because the devil is a master distractor, he will want to distract you from the presence of God. He will want to make that problem overwhelming, as if it is greater than God. But is there anything greater than God? You know it, but most cases will forget about it. So your attitude to Goliath will determine how your altitude will be. Everyone will always have a Goliath. See that your GCSE or your A-levels or even your master's degree or your bachelor's degree, or your letter of employment, or the application letter you have written, or promotion, or who should I marry? Where should we live? Should we get the mortgage now? Where there is inflation? By the way, there's nothing stopping you to get your mortgage. Don't look at the weather. Don't look at the atmosphere. Look at God. If God can do it, he will do it regardless of the atmosphere. That is your faith. This was the same measure of faith that was in David. How did David fight off Goliath? With a measure of faith, obviously. He said, the Lord who delivered me, mark the word, the Lord who delivered me in the past tense, he will deliver me. Make that your response and attitude to every challenge that comes our way. There is nothing that is impossible for God to do. Even this one will pass. Amen? I said, even this one will pass. It's by faith. Your God has given you a measure of faith to confront your Goliath. And Goliath comes in different shape and different size. There's always a precedence in God. The Lord will deliver me. You see, the Lord. David began with the Lord. Faith begins and ends with the Lord. There's always a precedence in God, a reference to what God has done before. Many failed before they even start, because they set out to do what they set out to do has no relation to God in the past. David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. Everyone say, this Philistine. This Philistine is that enemy of progress in our lives. This Philistine is that one that stands against your progress. Rather than you submitting, they will submit.
Amen.
Amen. He will deliver you. Number two, not only has God given each of us a measure of faith to help us in every situation of life, a measure of faith will help you start off to victory. It is a prophetic declaration to usher in your victory as the new year, this current year, is coming to an end, and God still has my own miracle to perform. I don't know about yours. Before the end of this year, every miracle that we are expecting from God, you and I, it will come.
Amen.
There shall not be a carryover of the miracle.
Amen.
God will give us what is due for this year.
Amen.
And a new one will begin the next year.
Amen.
That is a measure of faith, making proclamation, declaration. That is what the measure of faith will do. It will help you start off to victory. Bible says, now thanks be unto God who always leads us to triumph in Christ Jesus, and make known the knowledge. Make known his knowledge to us in every place. Is that not 2 Corinthians 2:14? God always leads us to triumph in victory. and make known the fragrance of his knowledge to us in every place. You see, everywhere you go, you smell of the knowledge of the glory of God. That is what some people fight off. But rather than you leaving that place for them, they will be the one to live for you. Amen? That is what you and I carry. You don't need to put on all those, I don't want to call the name of those perfume, the different one that we use. But the one that is authentic is the one that smells from the knowledge of God that we carry. Verse 48 of that one, Samuel 17. So it was when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hurried and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead. This is what is going to happen to your Goliath. And he fell on his face to the earth. Who says Goliath cannot fall? Who says you cannot move forward in life? Who is he that said a thing when the Lord has not commanded it? You will rise. You will win. You will overcome. In this land, God has prepared a place for you, and you will occupy. Say amen if you believe. The next verse, 50. So David prevailed, you too will prevail, over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him. But it's not everyone that can evaluate themselves honestly. A honest assessment of your chances to make a progress in life, and you present this before God, gives you, increase your chance or chances of making it in life. Joseph was a young and a promising man. He knew God was with him, even when his brothers, his own blood brothers, sold him off. Is this quarrel coming from your own blood brothers or sisters, or even someone you so closely knit together with? There's always a precedent in the word of God. Look at it. He had a dream when he was young, Joseph. He saw the stars, isn't it? He saw the sun, the moon, and 11 stars all bowing down to him. Even his closest relative said, just shut up. What do you think? We will bow down to you. It's not everything that God shows you that you must tell people. There are some things that you need to pray until they happen. You know it, just like the pregnant woman. The day you knew you conceived, it's only you that knew. And you told your partner or your spouse, it has happened. In this commission, we always tell people, you don't need to tell them from abroad. Just let the two of you know it and be praying until the day of delivery. You don't want to expand the fight. You know what I mean? You want to focus on this one, which is a good practice. So Joseph had a dream when he was younger that shaped his life going forward. What do you call that? A measure of faith. Joseph held on to it because this is what is going to pan out his life. And nothing could stop that. Genesis 37, 7 to 9. Joseph knew that God was with him, even when those things happened to him. And going forward, amidst all the conflict of interest that came his way and all the contradictions. There, and it came to pass, verse 7, after these things, that his master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph. And she said, lie with me. Oh, that was Genesis 39. Yes, thank you. Lie with me. But he refused and said to his master's wife, look, my master does not know what is with me in the house. And he has committed all that he has to my hand. Next verse. There is no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Was that not a measure of faith in operation that begins with God and ends with God? A reference to God that helps you how to handle whatever challenge you are confronted with. That's your measure of faith in operation. How can I do this wickedness and sin against God? Verse 10. So it was, as she spoke to Joseph day by day. Everybody say day by day. Devil is always a bad devil. It will not let you go just like that. It will persist. It will persist. But God has gone ahead. See, God has gone ahead of Joseph. God has prepared Joseph for such a time like this. So it was, as she spoke to Joseph day by day, that he did not heed her to lie with her or to be with her. It was the faith Joseph had in God that prepared him for this occasion, from the prison to the palace. I don't know where you are in transit. I know you are in transit, but don't lose sight of where you are going and don't forget where you began. Number three, a measure of faith is a solution to the life of falsehood. Yes, it's a solution to the life of falsehood. Today, many people are not real. They are pretenders. Acts chapter 19, verse 13. Acts chapter 19, verse 13. Now there were some itinerant Jewish exorcists who tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those with evil spirits. Invoke the name of Jesus over evil spirit? How can someone invoke the name of Jesus? What does it mean to invoke the name of Jesus? They will say, I bind you by Jesus, whom Paul proclaims. That is how to invoke the name of Jesus. Using the name of Jesus to command unclean spirit, evil spirit, to come out of the place. But what sort of people can do this? Is it for everyone? Let's find out. The seven sons of Sceva here, they were invoking the name of Jesus. And look at how they say, they will say, I bind you by Jesus. This is to show that they were only making reference to what they have seen. I bind you by Jesus. And never you think that, you know, there's some myth that we have to demystify. Because some people think that demons cannot call the name of Jesus. But who called the name of Jesus here? Was it not demons that said it? So it's not true. Say, I bind you by Jesus. So demons can call Jesus. You see? Even demons believe. And they tremble. See? But the only thing they have not done is to accept him as Lord and Savior. The New International Version says, some Jews who went around driving out evil spirit. That's how to invoke the name of Jesus. You invoke the name of Jesus by commanding demons to come out. But is it everybody that can do this? Is it everybody? Mark chapter 16, verse 17 tells us. And these signs, Mark chapter 16, verse 17, Jesus said, and these signs will follow those who believe. Only believers can invoke the name of Jesus and command evil spirit to come out. So I put it to you, therefore, these itinerant Jewish exorcists were pretenders. They were putting on themselves as if they are believers, but they are not believers. And look at verse 14 of that Act chapter 19. Verse 14 of that Act chapter 19, seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. They were lying to people. They were not living a lifestyle of honesty. What were they doing? They are assuming roles meant for believers. They are looking for recognition before people. They are looking for signs at all costs. You know, you have something in you as a believer that the world does not have. You have Jesus. And that is your ticket to a life, to a victorious life. Amen? Don't let anyone deny you of your right. Verse 15. Eventually, one of the evil spirits answered them. Can you see? One of the evil spirits answered them. Jesus, I know. Can you see? Call Jesus. And I know Paul. Even know Paul. But who are you? It's not asking for their name. It's asking for the authority. Who gave you authority to call that name? There are two myths we want to demystify. Number one, that evil spirits or demons cannot speak. Did you hear them speak now? They answered. This is not true that they cannot speak. They speak. They use the voice of someone that they are possessed to speak. It will sound as if you recognize that voice, but it's a fake. Amen? That is why we must cast them out. The second myth is that evil spirit cannot say the name of Jesus. Is that true? Can they say the name of Jesus? They can. So that's why you need to study your Bible very well. They can say the name of Jesus because we just had them say, Jesus, I know. It's because they know Jesus. That's why he called the name of Jesus. But God has given each one of us a measure of faith, because without it, we cannot please God. Number three, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 tells us the third reason. I'll get to that, or not, the fourth reason rather. I'll get to that very shortly. Hebrews 11, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. We're talking about him. Who is him? God. Do you want to be a man pleaser or God pleaser? To be a God pleaser is by faith. A measure of faith has been given to you. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Because of time, I will reserve the last three benefits why we need that measure of faith. But in that verse, 11, verse 6 of that Hebrew 11, it tells us the fourth reason, that a measure of faith is given to you and I to do what? To please God. I want to stop here because I'm seeing some people sleeping there. I want to stop. Hallelujah. Let's stand up on our feet. a measure of faith. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, the scripture says, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is an overcomer here? Aha. I am also an overcomer. You are an overcomer because of the measure of faith that God has given you. You are a victor, not a victim. So in this next phase of your life, you will do everything. You will increase in faith. You'll be strengthened in faith. You will grow in faith so that you become an overcomer. Raise up your voices to God. Ask him to help you in this next journey, that the faith that God has given you is a measure of faith. You want that faith to be strengthened. There's a great faith. There's a little faith. There's a big faith. There's a small faith. Every one of them has a demonstration and has an effect. How do you want your faith to be? A great faith? Small faith? Little faith? Ask God. With the measure of faith you have given me, I want to use it to become an overcomer. The next point is that God has given you a measure of faith to make you victorious and an overcomer in this life. Ask him to help you. You will not relent. You will not give up. You will win. And if you have there, and you do not have this faith in the Lord Jesus, you do not believe in God, I want you to start thinking, reflecting on it. But as many as believe him, to them, he gave them the right to become children of God. As many that received him, he gave them the right to become children of God, even them that believe on his name. When you receive him, he gives you the power of sonship. When you receive him, he gives you the power of sonship because you believe that he is indeed the Son of God. Are you out there and you're having conflicts of interest in this? Who is Jesus? I've come to tell you, he is the Son of God. He is the Savior of the world. He is the one that offered his own life as an atoning sacrifice for our sins, the sins of the world. He paid the price so that you don't have to. He saved you and I so that we don't have to save ourselves with our own life. Because you cannot even save yourself. Why don't you ask him to help you? He said, come unto me, those who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You have been troubled on every side. Do you know the solution is in Christ? Because when a man turns to God, the veil, the blindness of the mind is removed. Let's solve this case once and for all. Let the box stop here. Why don't you ask the Lord to save you? First, to forgive you of all your trespasses and transgressions. Make up your mind to stop them. Ask him to help you. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Let's receive the gift of God through Christ Jesus. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior, to teach you the way to go. In this new month, you want a new relationship with Jesus. You are not too young, you are not too old to accept him as your Lord and Savior. Let's ask him. Go ahead. He hears you wherever you are. Whatever your condition, he hears you. When you receive him, He will give you the power of sonship. For faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. As you hear right now, he has given you a measure of faith. As you hear him right now, he is giving you a measure of faith. He is giving you a measure of faith right now to believe him. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior. Ask him to save you. Lord will bless you. Begin to thank him. Begin to thank him. He will give you direction. He will give you direction. Lord will bless you. Lord will thank you. 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 We want to hear from you. We just thank him. Thank him. This is a new start. This is a new beginning. Many of you will be keen. It will give you that appetite to study the Bible more, to have questions, to find answers to some mind-boggling troubles or questions. Mind-boggling questions. Lord will bless you. Lord will bless you. Lord will bless you. We give you praise. Thanks, I give you thanks for have done. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. My soul I found rest. Oh Lord, I give you thanks. I give you thanks. I give you thanks. Thanks, thanks. Oh, I give you. It's coming from you. For all you have done, I am so blessed. I am so blessed. My souls have found rest. Oh Lord, I give you thanks. And so, Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Accept our thanks, oh God, because we appreciate you. Accept our thanks, oh God, for all that you have done in our lives. We ask for more, oh Lord. Do you promise not to leave us, nor forsake us? Help us, oh God. We receive your word. We receive your lordship. We receive you as our Savior. Take us to that destiny you have prepared for us. Before the end of this month, in this new month, we see the testimony. We will declare the testimony. For the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. We are the simple ones, oh God. Make us wise. Lord will bless you. In Jesus' holy and anointed name, we have prayed.
Amen.
Come on, clap those hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Please take care.